But that's what you have to do.
That one of the readers should be Brett.
I think so.
Why?
Because you were so enthusiastic and, you know, I like the things you like. And so
I mean, sure is.
Brent suggested it.
Oh, well.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
That's true. That,
wait, let me check. Right, right?
Yeah.
Then why don't you play Alcibiades too?
Okay.
All right? All right. Now, if this launches you, remember, into some dramatic career, finders be,
finders be.
Let's establish that early.
You see the problem?
We should go off and forget it.
And we need a Socrates.
Is he in this again?
Right.
Ubiquitous.
Why is that?
We need someone for lights, and we need a producer, and we need many things this evening, don't we? So we need someone who's willing to cast, casting director. Right, David, who should we cast for Socrates tonight?
I'm wondering what I'm going to say.
Are there any volunteers?
Yes, Chris volunteered.
For what?
Well, and it's set.
Oh, where aren't you going to?
Yes, he was in the Marines.
He's the casting director, David. Casting director David.
Wait a minute, let's make sure. Shall we vote on it?
Yes.
Of course.
Everybody steps back.
Everybody steps back. There's only one volunteer. Whatever you guys want to start.
Loud.
Alcibiades, are you on your way to offer a prayer to the god?
I am, certainly, Socrates.
You seem, let me say, to have a gloomy look, and keep your eyes on the ground as though you were pondering something.
And what might one ponder, Socrates?
The greatest of questions, Alcibiades, as I believe. For tell me, in heaven's name, do you not think that the gods sometimes grant in part, but in part refuse what we ask of them in our private and public prayers, and gratify some people but not others?
I do, certainly.
Then you would agree that one should take great precautions against falling unawares into error of praying for great evils in the belief that they are good, while the gods happen to be disposed to grant freely what one is praying for. Just as Oedipus, they say, suddenly prayed that his sons might divide their patrimony with the sword. It was open to him to pray that his present evils might by some means be averted, but he invoked others in addition to those which he had already. Wherefore, not only were those words of his accomplished, but many other dread results therefrom, which I think there is no need to recount in detail.
But you have instanced a madman, Socrates. Why do you suppose that anyone could bring himself, while he was in a sound state, to utter such a prayer?
Do you regard madness as the opposite of wisdom?
Certainly I do.
Are there some men whom you regard as unwise and others as wise?
Why, yes.
Come then, let us consider who these people are. We have admitted that some are unwise, some wise, and others mad.
Yes, we have.
And again, there are some in sound health.
There are.
And others also who are in ill health.
Quite so.
And they are not the same?
No, indeed.
And are there any others besides who are found to be in neither state?
No, to be sure.
For a human being must needs be either sick or not sick.
I agree.
Well then, do you hold the same view about wisdom and unwisdom?
How do you mean?
Tell me, do you think it is only possible to be either wise or unwise? Or is there some third condition between these which makes a man neither wise nor unwise?
No, there is not.
So he must needs be in one or the other of these two conditions.
I agree.
And you remember that you admitted that madness is the opposite of wisdom?
I do.
Further, that there is no third condition between these which makes a man neither wise nor unwise?
Yes, I admitted that.
Well now, can there possibly be two opposites of one thing?
By no means.
Then it looks as though unwisdom and madness were the same.
Yes, apparently.
So we shall be right, Alcibiades, in saying that all unwise persons are mad. For example, such of your contemporaries as happen to be unwise, some such there are, and of your elders even. For tell me, in heaven's name, do you not think that in our city the wise people are but few, whereas the majority are unwise, and these you call mad?
I do.
Well, do you suppose we could safely live with so many madmen as our fellow citizens, and should not long ago have paid the penalty for it in knocks and blows at their hands, and all the usual proceedings of madmen? Consider now, my wonderful friend, whether the case is not quite different.
Well, it must be, Socrates, for it looks as though it were not as I thought.
And I think so too. But there is another way of regarding it.
I wonder what way you mean.
Well, I will tell you. We conceive there are some who are sick, do we not?
We do, to be sure.
And do you believe that a sick man must necessarily have the gout, or a fever, or ophthalmia? Do you not think that although he may be afflicted in none of these ways, he may be suffering from some other disease? For surely there are many of them. These are not the only ones.
I agree.
And is every ophthalmia, in your opinion, a disease?
Yes.
And is every disease also ophthalmia?
No, I should think not. Still, I am in doubt as to my meaning.
Well, if you will attend to me, two together will be searching, and so mayhap we shall find what we seek.
Nay, but I am attending, Socrates, to the best of my power.
Then we have admitted that while every ophthalmia is a disease, every disease, on the other hand, is not ophthalmia.
We have.
And our admission seems to be quite right. For everyone in a fever is sick, but yet not everyone who is sick has a fever for the gout or ophthalmia, I take it. Though everything of the sort is a disease, it differs, to quote those whom we call doctors, in its manifestation. For they are not all alike, nor of like effect, but each works according to its own faculty, and yet all are diseases. In the same way we conceive of some men as artisans, do we not?
Certainly.
That is, cobblers and carpenters and statuaries and a host of others, whom we need not mention in particular. But anyway, they have their several departments of craft, and all of them are craftsmen. Yet, they are not all carpenters or cobblers or statuaries, though these taken together are craftsmen.
No, indeed.
In the same way, then, have men divided unwisdom also among them, and those who have the largest share of it we call mad, and those who have a little less, dolts and idiots. Though people who prefer to use the mildest language term them sometimes romantic, sometimes simple-minded, or again innocent, and inexperienced, or obtuse. And many another name will you find if you look for more. But all these things are unwisdom, though they differ, as we observe, that one art or one disease differs from another. Or how does it strike you?
That is my view.
Then let us turn at this point and retrace our steps. For we said, you know, at the beginning that we must consider who the unwise can be and who the wise. For we had admitted that there are such persons, had we not?
Yes, we have admitted it.
Then you conceive those to be wise who know what one ought to do and say.
I do.
And which are the unwise, those who know neither of these things?
The same.
And those who know neither of these things will say and do unawares what one ought not.
Apparently.
Well, just such a person as I was saying, Alcibiades, was Oedipus, and even in our time you will find many who do the same, not in a fit of anger as he was. They think they pray not for something evil, but for something good. He neither prayed for that nor thought he did, but there are others who are in the opposite case. For I imagine that if the God to whom you are now going should appear to you and first ask you, before you made any prayer, whether you would be content to become sovereign of the Athenian state, and on your accounting this as something foreign and unimportant, should add, and of all the Greeks also. And if he saw you were still unsatisfied unless he promised you besides the mastery of all Europe, and should not merely promise you that, but on the selfsame day a recognition by all men, if you so desired, of Alcibiades, son of Athenius, as their sovereign, I imagine you would actually depart in a transport of delight, as having secured the greatest of goods.
So would anybody else, I imagine, Socrates, at such a stroke of luck.
But still you would not wish to sacrifice your life, even for the territory and sovereignty of all the Greeks and barbarians together.
I should think not. How could I, without a prospect of making any use of them?
And what if you had a prospect of making an evil and injurious use of them? Not in this case either.
No, indeed.
So you see, it is not safe either to accept casually what one is given, or to pray for one's own advancement if one is going to be injured in consequence, or deprived of one's life altogether. Yet we could tell of many ere now who, having desired sovereignty and endeavored to secure it, with the idea of working for their good, have lost their lives by plots which their sovereignty has provoked. And I expect you're not unacquainted with certain events of a day or two ago, when Archelaus, the monarch of Macedonia, was slain by his favorite, who was as much in love with the monarchy as Archelaus was with him, and who killed his lover with the expectation of being not only the monarch, but also a happy man. But after holding the monarchy for 3 or 4 days, he was plotted against by others in his turn and perished. We have only to look at some of our own citizens, and these are examples that we know, not by hearsay, but by personal observation, who in their time have desired to hold military command and have obtained it, and see how some to this very day are exiles from our own city, while others have lost their lives. And even those who are deemed to be faring best have not only gone through many dangers and terrors in holding their command, but on returning home have continued to be as sorely besieged by informers as they were by the enemy, so that some of them wished to heaven that they had been anything but commanders rather than have held such appointments. Of course, if these dangers and toils were conducive to our advantage, there would be some reason for them, but the case is quite the contrary. And you will find it is just the same in regard to children. Some people have been known to pray that they might have them, and when they have got them, have fallen into the greatest disasters and pains. For some have had children that were utterly bad, and have spent their whole lives in vexation, while others, though they have had good ones, were bereft of them by disasters that overtook them, and thus were cast into as great a misfortune as the others, and wished that no children at all had been born to them. But nevertheless, with all this plain evidence, and a great deal more of a similar kind before men's eyes, it is rare to find anyone who has either declined what was offered to him, or when he was likely to gain something like that, refrained from praying. Most men would not decline to offer the offer of either a monarchy or a generalship, or of any of the various other things which bring with them harm rather than benefit, but would even pray to be granted them in cases where they were lacking. But after a little while they often change their tune and retract all their former prayers. I question, therefore, if men are not really wrong in blaming the gods as the authors of their ills, when they themselves, by their own presumption, or unwisdom, as we shall say, have gotten them more than destined sorrows. It would seem, at any rate, Alcibiades, that one old poet had some wisdom, for I conceive it was because he had some foolish friends whom he saw working and praying for things that were not for their advantage, though they supposed to be by them, that he had made a common prayer on behalf of them all, in terms of something like this: King Zeus, give unto us what is good, whether we pray or pray not, but what is give unto us what is good, whether we pray or pray not, but what is grievous, even if we pray for it, do thou avert. So then, to my mind, the poet spoke well and soundly, but if you have thought of an answer to his words, do not be silent.
It is difficult, Socrates, to gainsay what has been well spoken. One thing, however, I do observe. How many evils are caused to men by ignorance, when, as it seems, we are beguiled by her not only into doing, but worst of all, into praying to be granted the greatest evils. Now that is a thing that no one would suppose of himself. Each of us would rather suppose he was competent to pray for his own greatest good, not his greatest evil. Why, that would seem, in truth, more like some sort of curse than a prayer.
But perhaps, my excellent friend, some person who is wiser than either you or I may say we are wrong to be so free with our abuse of ignorance, unless we can add that it is ignorance of certain things, and is a good to certain persons in certain conditions, as to those others it is an evil.
How do you mean? Can there be anything of which it is better for anybody, in any condition whatsoever, to be ignorant than cognizant?
I believe so, and do not you?
No, indeed, upon my word.
But surely I shall not have to tax you with an inclination to commit such an act against your own mother, as Orestes and Alcmaeon, and any others who have followed their example are said to have committed against theirs.
No unlucky words in heaven's name, Socrates.
Why, it is not the person who says, Alcibiades, that you would not like to be guilty of such an act, whom you should bid avoid unlucky words, but much rather him who might say the contrary. Since the act seems to you so very dreadful as to be unfit even for such casual mention. But do you think that Orestes, if he had had all his wits about him, and had known what was best for him to do, would have brought himself to commit any act of this sort?
No, indeed.
Nor would anyone else, I imagine.
No.
Then it seems that ignorance of what is best, and to be ignorant of the best, is a bad thing.
I agree.
And not only for the person himself, but for everyone else?
Yes.
Then let us consider this further case. Suppose it should quite suddenly occur to you, to your mind, that you had better take a dagger and go to the door of Heracles, your own guardian and friend, and ask if he were at home with the design of killing just him and no one else, and the servant said he was at home. Now, I do not say that you would be inclined to do any such thing, but I suppose, if you are under the impression which at some moment may well be present, surely to the mind of a man who is ignorant of the best, that what is really the worst is best at some moment, or do you not agree?
Quite so.
Well then, if you went indoors and saw Pericles himself, but did not know him, and thought he was somebody else, would you still venture to kill him?
No, upon my word, I should think not.
For your man was, I presume, not anyone you met, but that particular person whom you wished to kill.
Yes.
And although you might make a number of attempts, if you always failed to know Pericles when you were about to commit the act, you would never attack him.
No, indeed.
Well, now, do you suppose that Orestes would ever have attacked his mother if he had similarly failed to know her?
I do not think he would.
For presumably, he too had no intention of killing the first woman he met, or anybody else's mother, but only his own.
That is so.
Then to be ignorant in such matters is better for those who are so disposed and have formed such resolves.
Apparently.
So you see that ignorance of certain things is for certain persons in certain states a good, not an evil, as you supposed just now.
It seems to be.
Then if you care to consider the sequel of this, I dare say it will surprise you.
What may that be, Socrates?
I mean that, generally speaking, it rather looks as though the possession of the sciences as a whole, if it does not include possession of the science of the best, will in a few instances help, but in most will harm the owner. Consider it this way. Must it not be the case, in your opinion, that when we are about to do or say anything, we first suppose that we know, or do really know, or do really know the thing we so confidently intend to say or do?
I think so.
Well, take orators, for example. They either know, or they think they know, how to advise us on various occasions. Some about war and peace, and others about building walls or fitting up harbors. And in a word, whatever the city does to another city, or within herself, all comes about by the advice of the orators.
That is true.
Then observe the consequence.
If I am able.
Why, should we call men either wise or unwise?
I do.
And the many unwise, and the few wise.
Precisely.
And in either case, you name them in reference to something?
Yes.
Then do you call a man wise who knows how to give advice without knowing whether and when it is better to act upon it?
No, indeed.
Nor, I conceive, a man who knows what war is in itself without knowing when or for how long a time it is better to make war.
Agreed.
Nor, again, a man who knows how to kill another or seize his property or make him an exile from his native land without knowing when or to whom it is better so to behave.
No, to be sure.
Then it is a man who knows something of this sort, and is assisted by knowledge of what is best, and this is surely the same as knowledge of the beneficial, is it not?
Yes.
And we shall call him wise, and a competent adviser both of the city and of his own self. But a man not so qualified we shall call the opposite of these. How do you think?
I agree.
And what of a man who knows how to ride or shoot, or else to box or wrestle, or contend in any other sport, or do anything that we know by rule of art? What do you call him who knows what is better done by rule of that particular art? Do you not say that he who goes by the rules of riding is a good rider?
I do.
And the rules of boxing, I suppose, make a good boxer, and those of flute playing a good flute player, and so on, and so on the same lines, I presume, with the rest. Or is there any difference?
No, it is as you say.
Then do you think it is inevitable that he who has some knowledge about these things should also be a wise man? Or shall we say he comes far short of it?
Far short of it, I declare.
Then, what sort of state do you suppose it would be where the people were good bowmen and flute players, together with athletes and artists in general, and mingled with these men, whom we have just mentioned as knowing war in itself and slaughter in itself, and orator windbags, too, with their political bluster, but all of them lacked this knowledge of the best, and none knew when or upon whom it was better made more to respect the parents.
A paltry one, I should call it, Socrates.
Yes, you would, I expect, when you saw each one of them vying with the other and assigning the largest part in the conduct of the state to that wherein himself is found most excellent. I mean, what is done best by the rule of his particular art. While he is generally off the track of what is best for the state and for himself, because, I conceive, he has put his trust and opinion apart from intelligence. In these circumstances, should we not be right in saying that such a state is one great mass of turmoil and lawlessness?
We should, upon my word.
And we took it to be necessary that we should first think we know, or really know, anything that we intend either to do or to say with facility?
We did.
And if a man does what he knows or thinks he knows, and is assisted by knowing how to make it beneficial, we shall find him profitable both to the city and to himself?
Certainly.
But if, I suppose, he does the contrary? He will not be so either to the city or to himself.
No, indeed.
Well then, you still take the same view now as before, or do you think differently?
No, I take the same view.
And you said you called the many unwise and the few wise?
I did.
So now we repeat our statement that the many have missed getting the best because in most cases, I conceive, they have put their trust in opinion apart from intelligence.
Yes.
Then it is an advantage to the many neither to know nor to think they know anything if they are going to be especially eager to do what they know or think they know, but are likely on the whole and doing it to be injured rather than benefited.
That is very true.
So you see that when I said it looked as though the possession of the sciences as a whole, where it did not include the science of the best, in a few cases helped, but it did not harm the owner, I was evidently right in every truth. In very truth, was I not?
Though I did not then, I think so now, Socrates.
Hence the state, or soul, that is to live aright, must hold fast to this knowledge, exactly as a sick man does to a doctor, or as he would voyage safely does to a pilot. For without this, the more briskly it is wafted by fortune either to the acquisition of wealth or to bodily strength or aught else of the sort, the greater will be the mistakes in which these things, it would seem, must needs involve it. And he who has acquired the so-called mastery of learning and arts, but is destitute of this knowledge and compelled by this or that one among those others, is sure to meet with much rough weather, as he truly deserves. Since I imagine he must continue without a pilot on the high seas, and has only the brief span of his life in which to run his course, so that this case aptly fits the saying of the poet in which he complains of somebody or other that full many crafts he knew, but still he knew them all so very ill.
Why, how on earth is a poet saying apposite, Socrates, for to my mind it has nothing to do with the point?
It is very much to the point, but he, good sir, like almost every other poet, speaks in riddles. For poetry as a whole is by nature inclined to riddling, and it is not every man who can apprehend it. And furthermore, besides having this natural tendency, when he gets hold of a grudging person who wishes not to show forth to us his own wisdom, but to conceal it as much as possible, we find it an extraordinarily difficult matter to make out whatever this or that one of them may mean. For surely you do not suppose that Homer, divinest and wisest of poets, did not know it was impossible to know ill. For it is he who said to Magitus that he knew many things, but knew them all ill. But it is a riddle, I think, in which he has made ill stand for evil, and knew for to know. So if we put it together, letting the meter go, indeed, but grasping his meaning, we get this. Full many crafts he knew, but it was evil for him to know them all. Then clearly it was evil for him to know many things. He was in fact a paltry fellow, assuming we are to believe what we had previously argued.
But I think we may, Socrates, at least, if I cannot believe those arguments of ours, I shall find it hard to trust any others.
And you are right in so thinking?
Then again, I think not.
But come now, in heaven's name, for I suppose you see how great and strange is our perplexity, in which you, as it seems to me, have a share. For you change about from this side to that without settling down for a moment, but as soon as you're firmly convinced of a thing, you seem to slip out of it again, and cease to hold the same view. Well, if the God to whom you're going should even now appear to you and ask, before you uttered any prayer, whether you would be content to obtain one of these things which were mentioned at the beginning, or whether he should leave you to pray as you were, how do you suppose you would make the best of your chance? By accepting this offer, or by praying for something on your own account?
Well, by the gods, I could not answer your question, Socrates, offhand. Why, I take it to be a fatuous request, when it is really a case for great caution, lest one pray unawares for what is evil while thinking it to be one's good. And then after a little while, as you were saying, one change one's tune and retract all one's former prayers.
And did not the poet whom I quoted at the beginning of our discussion know more than we, when he bade us pray for the averting of what is grievous, even though we pray for it?
I think so.
Then it is their admiration of this poet, Alcibiades, or perhaps the result of their own study that causes the Spartans to offer a similar prayer, whether the occasion be private or public, that the gods will give them for their own benefit the beautiful as well as the good. More than this, no one can ever hear them pray for. The consequence is that to the present time they have been just as fortunate as any other people. And if it has befallen them not to be invariably fortunate, it was anyhow not owing to their prayer. It rests with the gods, I conceive, to give us either what we may pray for or the reverse. And I would like to give you an account of something else, which I once heard from some of my seniors. A quarrel having arisen between the Athenians and the Spartans. It befell our city to be always unsuccessful in every battle by land and sea, and she could never win a victory. So the Athenians, in their annoyance at this result, and at a loss for some means of finding deliverance from the trouble they were in, took counsel together and decided that the best thing they could do was to send and inquire of Amon, and moreover, to ask also for what reason the gods granted victory to the Spartans rather than to themselves. For we, such was the message, offer up to them more and finer sacrifices than any of the Greeks, and have adorned their temples with votive emblems, as no other people have done, and presented to the gods the costliest and stateliest possessions year by year, and spent more money thus than all the rest of the Greeks together. But the Spartans have never taken any such pains, and indeed are so neglectful in their behavior to the gods that they make a practice of sacrificing defective victims, and generally are very much behind us in the honors that they pay, though the wealth they possess is quite equal to that of our city. When they had so spoken and added the question what they should do in order to find a deliverance from the trouble they were in, the prophet's only answer, evidently it was all that the god allowed, was to call them to him and say, "Thus saith Amon to the Athenians, I would rather have the reverent reserve of the Spartans than all the ritual of the Greeks." So much he said, and not a word further. Now, by reverent reserve, I suppose the god can only mean their prayer, since in fact it differs greatly from those that are generally offered. For the Greeks in general either lead up bulls with gilded horns, or else present the gods with votive emblems, and pray for any odd thing, whether it be good or bad. So when the gods hear their irreverent speech, they reject all these costly processions and sacrifices. Whereas I think we ought to be very cautious and fully consider what is to be said and what is not. And in Homer, too, you will find other tales of a similar sort, for he relates how the Trojans, in making their bivouac, sacrificed to the immortals perfect hecatombs, and how the winds bore the sweet savor from the plains of heaven. But the blessed gods partook not of it, nor would have it, for deep was their hate against holy Ilium, and Priam, and the folk of Priam, of the good ashen sphere. So it was nothing to their purpose to sacrifice and pay tribute of gifts in vain, when they were hated by the gods. For it is not, I imagine, the way of the gods to be seduced with gifts like a base usurer. And indeed it is but silly talk of the ours if we claim to surpass the Spartans on this score. For it would be a strange thing if the gods had regard to our gifts and sacrifices instead of our souls, and the piety of and justice that may be found in any of us. Far rather at these, I believe you look than at those costly processions and sacrifices which are offered. It well may be by individual and state, year in, year out, though they may be offended greatly against the gods, or as greatly against their neighbors. But the gods are not to be won by bribes, and so they despise all these things, as Amon and the holy prophets say. Certainly it would seem that justice and wisdom are held in especial honor both by the gods and by men of intelligence. And wise and just are they alone who know what acts and words to use towards gods and men. But I should like now to hear what may be your opinion on the subject.
Why, Socrates, it in no way, no wise differs from yours and the gods, for indeed it would not be fitting for me to record my vote against the god.
And you remember you professed to be in great perplexity, lest you should pray unawares for evil, while supposing it to be good.
I do.
You see, then, how unsafe it is for you to approach the god with your prayers, for it may chance that when he hears your reverent speech, he will reject your sacrifice altogether, and you may perhaps be accorded some other bad thing as well. In my opinion, therefore, it is best to hold your peace, for I expect you will not consent to use a Spartan's prayer. You have such a romantic spirit to give it to the fairest of Polly's names. It is necessary, therefore, to bide one's time until one can learn how one should behave towards the gods and men.
Well, when will that time arrive, Socrates, and who is to be my instructor? For I feel I should very much like to see who the man is.
It is he who is concerned about you. But I think, as Homer relates how Athena removed the mist from the eyes of Diomedes, that he might well discern both god and man. So you too must first have the mist removed which now enwraps your soul, and then you will be ready to receive the means whereby you will discern both evil and good. For at present, I do not think you can do so.
Let him remove the mist, or whatever else he likes to call it, for I am prepared to obey every one of his commands without shirking, whoever the man may be, so long as I am to be the better for them.
I tell you, he on his part is prodigiously anxious to help you.
and I think it best to defer the sacrifice also till the time comes.
And you are quite right, for that is safer than running so serious a risk.
But how say you, Socrates? Look now, I will crown you with this garland, as I consider you to have given me such good advice. And to the gods we shall offer both garlands and all the other customary things when I see that day has come. And come it will ere long, if they are willing.
Well, I accept this gift, and anything else besides that you may give me, I shall be only too happy to accept. And as Euripides has made Creon say when he sees Tiresias wearing his wreaths, and hears that he has obtained them on account of his art, as first fruits of the spoils of war, as omen good I take thy victor's wreaths, for in the waves we labor, as thou knowest. So do I take this opinion of yours as a good omen. For I consider I am no less wave-tossed than Creon, and would like to come off victorious over your lovers.
Did you hear about the work?
And all the other. puns on the word. What Madman?
Oh, Ken's going to write a work. It's the dialogue on prayer between Muhammad and Ibn King.
Sorry, use this word pun.
Well, maybe there's some criteria for obstetric dialogue to be divided.
Well,
has to be a mother.
I think it's only fair.
Has to be a birth.
Yeah. Has to be a birth.
Or maybe a...
Certainly, but like it's still birth on this one. It doesn't seem like anything is going to come out of this. Oh, in any case, that's why I said maybe it's better we just dispense with that and try to understand the dialogue.
It could be a recursive dialogue.
Well, that's one of the themes in there, whether or not it's a curse.
A recurse. So we'll say that we understood the dialogue, but we don't know what dialogue it was.
Well, look here. Is there some problem that's here that prevents us to reflect on it? What's the issue?
Kind of like the implications of your words, isn't it? One issue, anyway.
What's that, Bob?
The very first issue, the implications of your words. You may unwittingly be asking for something that you really wouldn't want.
And I make that, later on there's that analogy when he talks about parents that have kids that they
love. Yes, that's, that seems to be one issue. But that's only one.
Self-knowledge. Are you asking for what you're really, what you shouldn't really want?
Because you're proceeding with opinion or with that.
Yeah, because you ask for good and evil.
The knowledge of the best comes in here pretty strong, too, towards the end. That's a home runner, That's
well, like a first time.
Spartans must have had something.
Without that, all the sciences are kaput.
Yeah, that was really nice.
That was
pretty
good.
The criteria for the best.
Who or what is Alcibiades?
Oh, Alcibiades.
Go ahead.
Well, he's the guy looking for a job.
He's looking for a job.
Critias is nephew.
He's the most
Pericles is ward. And he wants to be the most powerful, most well-known man.
Alcibiades was the most...
let's look it up. 239, 241.
Incomprehensible scoundrel in history.
Who are you going to ask?
That's right.
I did not do.
Yeah, 239, 241.
Yeah.
For I imagine that if the God to whom you are now going should appear to you and first ask you, before you made any prayer, whether you should be content to become sovereign of the Athenian state, and on your accounting, this says something poor and unimportant should add, and to all the Greeks also. And if so you were still unsatisfied, unless he promised you besides the mastery of all Europe, should not merely promise you, but on the very same day, no other day than that, recognition by all men who so desire. I imagine, if you actually heard that, you'd be departed into the land of bliss, pure delight, as having secured the greatest of goods, the best of all men, the best of all times, having received the greatest of all treasures. Is that what it was like? So, look here. How is he pictured as that? Here's sort of like, of course, it's true. So anyone would accept that such a stroke of luck.
Yeah.
So if a god were to appear to him, say, hey, is this what you want? Mm-hmm. He wouldn't take just being the ruler of the Greek people, or all the Greeks, but he would want recognition from all men.
The bad.
Even the bug.
What does that do to the problem?
It's really
expands the scope.
they call her a myth, but the words megalopsyche, is it? What is it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's not megaloprepa.
It's not Roman. Roman. It's megalopsyche. It's one of the kinds of aphronesis that he describes.
He's going to direct them.
It's megalos something.
Right? He's going to be a leader of all of those.
Yeah.
And therefore they're going to follow his advice. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Then they should would follow this advice.
You better know what he's talking about.
Now, what's the picture Socrates gives of the all men?
Well, mad. Are
you breaking me?
Ignorant or
I'm
mad?
Man.
Huh?
I don't. romantic.
Come on, what are the other two? He's got two groups, doesn't he?
Yeah.
What's the greater group?
Wise and unwise.
Wise and
unwise. Unwise is the greater.
Unwise or
mad?
Mad.
Well, that's just the question.
I'm not sure the madness is the same.
All right, now, there are two conditions for men, are they not, according to this dialogue? What are the two basic conditions?
Wise or unwise?
Yeah, right? Yeah. There are two basic conditions. Now, given this, right, given this fact, as a leader, he can do one or two things. Right? He can either lead them or leave them alone. Right? Either lead them or leave them alone. Well, and what is Alcibiades' view? The trouble with men is what? The trouble with mankind is what? They're ignorant. Mostly ignorant, right? These people are mostly ignorant. And the dreadful things they do because of their ignorance. But do you not agree with that? Right? The long litany of misdeeds of men who are ignorant is astonishing. That's very terrible, terrible, terrible. And therefore, he's going to lead them, he's going to cure them of their ignorance. Right? Because then they'd be better off if they weren't ignorant. Hmm. That's the way it would appear.
Not true, though.
Not true.
In
right.
some cases, they're better off being uninformed.
That's why that argument is so important.
I mean, being ignorant. Yeah,
that's a good argument.
Right? So therefore, look here. If they're better off left ignorant...
That's crazy.
Come on. If they, look here.
Then he's not going to bring about their benefits.
That's right. He's not going to bring their benefit by making them.
What if killing their guardians?
That's right.
Lives.
Right. If they, look here, if they are better off being ignorant, then what should he do of those two choices?
Leave them alone.
Leave them alone. And if he leaves them alone, when, wait a minute. What does he think would be the greatest luck? To gain the recognition from all men. Mm. Not just Greeks. Not just the fallen people.
Nothing but trouble.
It's nothing but trouble, because they're mad. They're nuts. Most people are nuts. Is that what's going on?
Who wants to gain...
So wait a minute, what would follow now? What would follow if he can demonstrate this theory? That they're better off bigger. Than that choice he has to face?
What would there be in it?
Yeah.
There'd be no one to lead.
Well, then he'd know. Yes, there are.
The wives.
The wives.
Only the wives.
Right, then he might be able to lead the wives.
If he was wise.
Yeah. Let's see, now we need an argument that should show. The wise are equally better off being left in their wisdom than they are by being led by his ignorance.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes.
But he was kind enough not to do that part of the dialogue.
Yeah, poor guy, he'd jump off a building. There's no place for Alcibiades.
Maybe that was better for him to be ignorant.
Almost mom and dad.
Yeah, not would have been the other side of the dialogue. It would have been fun for him to play with.
When they talk about sovereign of the Greeks, the word for sovereign is tyrant. He uses tyrant there, and also when he talks about, when he gives the example about the tyrants, but when he uses, like the other word, the hereditary king is Basileus, which is what he uses to Zeus in the prayer. And so Alcibiades is saying he'd like to be the biggest tyrant of all. He'd like to be a tyrant. If they could make him a tyrant, he'd like to be one.
Yeah. He's a tyrant, then he can leave all the ignorance.
And leave the ignorance.
Sure. But there should be, according to this argument, better off left alone.
Yeah.
So then he's left with an aspiring project, a great challenge, which will only bring about the worst of mankind.
Well, it went by so quick, but isn't there a catch in there that if he has the knowledge of the best, though? This is the Phaedrus argument, then. Isn't it kind of like, what person's, if this person right here in front of me right now is affected by this kind of speech to bring about this kind of action for the sake of the divine? And so, without knowing who would benefit by what, when, he'll suffer these consequences of applying all the arts in a manner that lacks the best. So he'll run. It seems like he'll run a random risk. You know, that argument runs the random risk, so just there'll be enough interactions where the benefit won't be arrived at. So it looks like that. How do you learn that one?
Mm-hmm.
Is that right, Pierre? Is that what you mean?
I think that can be said. Yeah.
He's going to leave, then he's going to leave and make them better. Because does he not say that all kinds of evils follow from these people and their ignorance? Then he has to leave them. There are only two kinds of knowledge, right, in terms of this dialogue. Right? He leaves them, the choice is. He may possess all the arts, but one, or the one. You know all the arts except that one that can benefit. Then you are mad.
Don't even get the check mark.
Irreverent speech is an irreverent speech, isn't it? almost pathological speech. He doesn't see the implications of it.
what he's asking for.
So, 255. You lack this knowledge of the best. Then, of course, you wouldn't know when or upon whom it was better to employ the respective art. That's what he would be as a leader. He would be directing all the arts to serve the purpose of the state. But none of those arts know when or upon whom it's better to employ their respective arts.
Rich quote, huh?
Okay.
269. For it would be a strange thing if the gods had regard to our gifts and sacrifices instead of our souls, and the piety and justice that may be found in any of us. Far rather at these, I believe, do they look than at our costly processions and sacrifices which are offered.
Especially eager to do what they know on the basis of the arts that they possess.
Yeah.
Well, then, only one thing follows. It's best done if greater advantages will occur if they neither know nor think they know anything.
Like a game of life, in one sense, isn't it? Like being able to see the implications of your words several stages down the line.
You know? Yeah, we have to talk about it better.
Right. You want to be the tyrant, and you don't know what that's going to bring about. You want to educate the ignorant, right? In all situations, you don't see it right on the surface level, you know.
Can't do what it is you want to do.
You know what kind of pattern that's going to result in, right? Your mother's teaching
you
how to use a gun.
Teach your mother how to use a 45.
It's like, it reminds me of the myth of Ur. Doesn't it feel like choosing lives? You don't see the implications.
That's what I thought
of. You know, wind up eating your kids.
Yeah.
Chooses to be there.
Yeah. You're eating by them. Yeah. Eating by them. So, on the conclusion on all the arts. Then it's an advantage to the many, neither to know nor to think they know anything. If they're going to be especially eager to do what they know, think they know. They're better. It's making them better. How do you want to make them better then? You're going to make them better, what should you do? It's to their advantage.
Keep them eager.
Keep them eager. Therefore, don't lead them.
Doubt.
So don't lead them, they're going to think, give them a purpose, give them a destiny, watch out.
That's the Tao Te Ching.
Or you just go around with a pin, play to keep lady everybody. Yeah.
All right, then, an advantage. And that's the idea of an art, isn't it? advantage to the many. Keep them barefoot and pregnant. Is that what you said?
That's one of that.
If you have the original version.
Yeah.
And don't let them go to school.
What does that do for universal education?
It's a certain kind
public
of
public school.
Let them like cell phone.
Clear then why he calls out Stenfield.
No.
No.
Well, thank you. That's a nice good point. Well, he had a conception. Conceived something. Yeah, if I can see, he's.
Well, sometimes it's better to have kids and sometimes leave.
Yeah, fair enough.
Only if you might be expected to have kids.
That's another
thing. Live in my opinion.
Well, by the gods, I could not answer your question, Socrates, offhand. Why? I take it to be a fatuous request. And it's really a case for great caution, at least one prayer, one pray unawares what is equal. Thinking it to be one's good. And then after a little while, as you were saying, change one's tune and retract all. As you're saying, maybe, unless you really know what you're praying for, you better not pray. What are you saying there? Whether he should lead you to pray as you were, being ignorant, how do you suppose you would make the best of your chance by accepting his offer or by praying for something on your own account? Well, if you saw people praying, you should stop them and say, hold it. Where are you going to pray? That's what he's doing, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
He's on his way to pray.
Not only that, he was going to make a sacrifice. Mm. I mean, this was not just a
had a coma.
Yes.
It's against the law in this country.
It is.
We can't walk into a church and do anything like that. It's
against the law. You're arrested. 15th of
April. It's worse in England.
Every place where up over 10%.
Every place where the translation has by heaven or upon my word is by Zeus. I've been counting the number of Zeus appearances in here. And you wouldn't know it because the translation, the guy is only translates, only gives Zeus in the poem. He doesn't give it in the by heavens and upon my word. But those are two ways he translates by this.
Well, you keep saying it's about prayer, and Pierre keeps saying that it's not about prayer, or that it's about keeping one from prayer.
Ah, and keeps one from prayer. How's that on structure?
I would change that it's about an opinion about, the obstetrics is an opinion about prayer. No. It's not like that.
Maybe it's at an early stage causing a mishear.
Well, he's about to lead a sacrifice.
The same thing with friends, too.
Might have asked somebody to do this, but now he's at least cautious about what he's afraid about.
He had an earlier stage than that.
We have to have more than a theory, that's why.
It's an abortion of an attempt to pray for a great dream.
Kind of a fun one on 369, right? I'd go all the way down, but especially the last couple of paragraphs. For it is not, I imagine, the way of the gods to be seduced to a gifts like a base usurer. And indeed, it's but silly talk of ours, we claim to surpass the Spartans on the score. For it would be a strange thing if the gods had regard to our gifts and sacrifices instead of our souls. And the piety and the justice that may be found in any of us. Far rather at these, I believe, do they look than at those costly possessions and sacrifices which are offered. It well may be, by individual and state, year in, year out, though they may have offended greatly against the gods, or as greatly against their neighbors. But the gods are not to be won by bribes, so they despise all these things, as they are. Holy God, so certainly it would seem that justice and wisdom are held in special honor, both by gods and by men of intelligence. Wise and just are they alone who know what acts and words to use towards gods and men. Therefore, we're the only ones who should pray.
Wise and just.
Right? Man of intelligence. Those are wise and just.
Yeah.
Right? Certainly it would seem that justice and wisdom are held in special honor both by gods, by men of intelligence. And wise and just are they alone who know what acts, words to use towards gods and men. Now he's going to be leading men, he's just going to pray. Right? Socrates is saying, hey, I got news for you. You're going to address yourself. Right? You're going to address yourself to men, right? Mm-hmm. Pray to the gods. Well, if you're not a man of intelligence, right? Good heavens! Because you need justice and wisdom. If you have that, then you know the words to use. And then you know the words to use, right? For these, right? And for that. But if not, what are you doing? Don't pray before your wives. God may in fact give you your prayers, and then you'll be really screwed. No, you have to, because that's why you're stupid.
That's right.
And that's why you're here. Because they alone are those who know what acts and words to use towards God's name. I love Alcibiades' answer. Why, Socrates? It in no wise differs from yours and the gods. For indeed, it would not be fitting for me to record my vote against the gods. What did you just say, Alcibiades? Well, I should like now to hear what may be your opinion on the subject. Why, Socrates, it doesn't differ from yours and the gods. Well, therefore,
He's among the wise. Is that right?
All three of them.
Yeah. Now, they add the addition. Mm-hmm. For indeed, it would not be fitting for me to record my vote against the God. What did he say again? For indeed, it would not be fitting for me to record my vote against the God.
Smart kid.
He doesn't want to go on record voting against the gods. Yeah. Although he may be voting against the gods.
That's what he's saying, isn't it?
Might be fitting.
I still want the recognition of all men, and I care about the gods in their heaven.
Whether I'm doing the right thing or not, praying for the right thing. Mm-hmm.
All right, so what's the solution? Do you see this? Would you follow the solution of 269, 271? You see then how unsafe it is for you to approach the God with your prayers. For it may chance that when he hears your reverent speech, he will reject your sacrifice altogether. And you may perhaps be accorded some other bad thing as well. My opinion, therefore, it's best to hold your peace. For I expect that you will not consent to use the Spartan's prayer. You have such a romantic spirit. To give it the fairest of folly's names. Says, you're mad, buddy. Yeah, right, I'll give you the fairest. I'll give you the fairest of all those names. Actually, you're nuts. It is necessary, therefore, to bide one's time until one can learn how one should behave towards gods and men. Therefore, what's he telling him? Cool your heels. Huh? I got news for you, kids. Don't pray and don't lead men. Bide your time, all right? Until you figure out this art that will benefit both yourself and your mom.
And I wouldn't call you a romantic unless you're a romantic.
For I expect you will not consent to use the Spartan's prayer. You have such a romantic spirit. To give it the fairest of folly's name. Remember the list we gave?
Actually, a pretty good speech.
Well then, wow. When will that time arrive, Socrates? Who's to be my instructor?
Yeah, how long will it take?
How long will it take? The time is running. The clock is running.
Getting home and get it all by 10 o'clock in the morning.
Maybe it's their instructor.
He wants to be a billionaire by the age there.
Right. He says, well, I'll tell you, unless the God removes the mist from your eyes, buddy, no one's going to be able to help you. You know, I mean, let's face it. You're in a fog. And it's going to take a God to lift that fog. And you know what? I don't think you'll be able to do a damn thing.
That's so interesting, the beginning of the first self-sobriety, because he said he refrained from talking for a long, many years until his divine voice.
Yeah.
And he said, this is the right time to talk. And then he was.
Yeah.
Was it then he would listen? It wasn't that he would listen, but that he was of an age. Was it that he was of an age or that? Because if he had talked to him before, he would have heard what he had to say. Well,
both.
I don't recall.
Both?
Yeah.
It is he who is concerned about you. But I think as Homer relates how Athena removed a mist in the eyes of Diomede, that he might well discern both God and man. So you too must first have the mist removed, which now enwraps your soul. And then you'll be ready to receive the means whereby you will discern both evil and good. For at present, I don't think you can do so. So, unless God, just like, with Athena, just wait around for her to remove the mist that enwraps your soul. All right, so stick around for a while.
There you go.
Well, that's a nice period of time, isn't it? Nice example to you.
Yeah.
And what period?
For the present, I don't think we can do so. Anything you do is work.
And it needs to be removed.
And it needs to be removed as the condition.
Well, he's talking to Socrates, and he's asking him who his instructor's going to be. He wants to see who the man is. So he doesn't see any value in Socrates as being someone who can help him.
Well, why don't we just finish that, okay, on page 271? Why don't you pick it up, Charlie?
Okay, from Roman.
Let him remove the mist, or whatever else he likes to call it.
Let him remove the mist, or whatever else he likes to call it. For I am prepared to obey every one of his commands without shirking, whoever the man may be, so long as I am to be the better for them. I tell you, he on his part, is prodigiously anxious to help you. Then I think it best to defer the sacrifice also till the time comes. And you are quite right, for that is safer than running so serious a risk. He said, how say you, Socrates? Look now, I will crown you with this garland, as I consider you have given me such good advice. And to the gods, we shall offer both garlands and all the other customary things when I see that day has come. And come it will ere long, if they are willing. Well, I accept this gift and anything else besides that you may give me. I shall be only too happy to accept. And as Euripides has made Creon say, when he sees Tiresias wearing his wreaths and hears that he has obtained them on account of his art as first fruits of the spoils of war, as omen good I take thy victor's wreaths, for in the ways we labor, as thou knowest. So do I take this opinion of yours as a good omen, for I consider I am no less wave-tossed than Creon, who would like to come off victorious over your lovers.
But, you know, the last page there, it looks like if you can stay with the words, what they can do.
You took the hint.
You want to put it off?
Yeah.
Yeah. You mean that smile about it? Yeah.
What I see that day is coming.
So it takes it as an omen.
I was just playing with an earlier image, and I was wondering, you know, to the Edo, is that literal? Then? Pierre, one thing I would like to offer, if I may, unless you're about to, in which case, just that ophthalmia that he offers as the disease that he's comparing is a disease of humors of the eye. So it's like a mist over the eye, coating the eye, causes you.
Oh, that's clever.
And that, isn't that curious?
Also curious, because that's the whole analogy in the first Alcibiades.
So are there three classes of men then? Is there a group between the ignorant and the wise?
Those who bide their time.
Those who, right, come on. Those who...
No, they don't.
No, they don't.
Abide, come on. Abide their time. And do not... Go ahead.
I think they know.
Lead the many.
Oh.
Or pray to...
Nor...
Pray out of season.
Nor pray... To gods. And who are the object of an obstetric art. Art? Third category. Then when he gets there, he'll be able to pray as he wants. These men, who will they lead? Right? The only way he could lead anybody would be to lead that group. It's the only group worth leading. And the obstetrics, the objects of the obstetric art. Can't lead the wise. Right? Can't lead the foolish. Right? So there's only one small group left. Those who are the objects of the wife. An obstetric art, right? So if we see Ken King over there in the Islamic Center, when the boys get down there to pray every day, saying, excuse me, wait a minute.
He tells you they're big on it there, too.
Right? We have a little talk.
Sure, this is fine. So there's a humorous thing in the house where I live. This one mentions praying for children. I live in a house with four guys. Mm-hmm. One of them made the prayer that he'd get a wife, he got a wife, and now he's got a problem.
You should have prayed for a wife without problem. That's right.
You prayed for the wrong thing. You should have prayed for a cattle.
Without problem.
Pray for a wife and stuff.
But there is that. There's a whole chance to do all of this with somebody. But they have to be in that third class.
Well, you might be able to get them out of the lower class into the middle class, but good luck.
Yeah, that's
fine. You do the old face switch. That give them the higher class and then give them the middle class. Bait and switch. Give them the higher class, and then at the last moment, just let them settle on the
right.
Third class. Offer them the one and give them the other.
That might work on reading. I'll study vocabulary. Have you noticed what's happening to our country?
And he'll say no.
Well, you should give the moral majority. If you tell him to hold up, boys. Don't get everybody to pray. That's what's wrong with the country. God is granting the prayers.
The questionnaire.
That's the real problem in the United States. God is granting the prayers the right way. They got so much money, they're influencing the gods. He's granting all those guys their prayers.
Devise a questionnaire to who's capable of leading and offering prayers.
Why not first? When you pray, what's the content of your prayer? Either consciously or unconsciously, if you please know the kinds of things that you desire or expect God to act as your intermediaries, that you may achieve or avoid the following things. Please listen to God in order.
Right.
Where did you get the idea that the one list is better than the other? Who taught you about this one list that you want and the other list that you want to avoid? It is, in fact, one is good and one is evil. You wouldn't want to get those two mixed up. These, when you have a fill-in. Then personal experience, you want to know, would you please list four or five people that you know? God has granted the prayers. Best of your knowledge, what's happened to them, and what their prayers, and what is the consequence of getting those goodies from the gods? Mm-hmm. And whether any man has willingly turned down prayers when they were granted by the gods. Or does everyone have to accept whatever God grants? You say, excuse me, I have time to think it over.
Yeah.
Wait a minute, right now.
Take that back.
Take your money. Yeah. Mm-hmm.